We are going to begin our study over the book of Mark. The reason I picked Mark was because it was the first gospel written, and we're going to get into that. And it's the shortest gospel, so it's kind of like a bullet of information that we're going to be getting. Just a couple of things about the book of Mark. Again, I said it was the shortest gospel. It contains 11,304 words. The second up is John with 15,635, then Matthew, 18,346, Luke at 19,482. So it's a really, really short gospel. Altogether, these synoptic gospels tell that one story of Christ. The word synoptic, the word syn means together, S-Y-N. Optic means seeing. So when you put these together, you're seeing together the full picture of what Christ did and the full gospels of, the recorded life of Christ through these authors. We'll also notice as we go through this book, the word immediately or straightway is going to be in there a lot of times. So I believe it's going to be at least 41 times just through this whole gospel. That word immediately is euthos, and that is actually in the New Testament 59 times. 41 of these times is going to be in Mark. So this is a quick gospel going from one section to another. Another thing about the gospel of Mark is there's a lot of action and reaction. So when Christ does something, people are really quick to react, and the description shows all that. And we're going to get into that as we get to see Jesus actually interact with these humans. Not only that, but we see a lot of the human side of Christ. We get to see how he's feeling whenever he's upset, whenever he feels sad. So Mark really captures the humanness of Christ in this. And so we're going to again begin an overview of the life, the teaching, and passion of Christ as documented by Mark. The subtitle I put for this first lesson is The Return of the Departed. So quick, we're going to do a small word study. And again, we're not even going to break into chapter 1, verse 1. We're just going to hang out in that right there, the gospel according to Mark, and get to know who Mark is. And then, Lord willing, next week we'll get into the lesson of chapter 1, verse 1. But gospel. When we hear the word gospel, a lot of times we think it's a book. That's where my mind goes to, or used to go to, when I heard the gospel. I'm like, yeah, I've read that book. I've read the gospel of Mark, Matt, Luke, or John. But the word is actually euangelion in Greek. And that means glad tidings of salvation through Christ, good tidings, or as we know it, good news. And so the gospel is something that in that time they would have known exactly what that means. I don't want to get too much into it because next week we're going to dig a little bit more. And then according to, which means kata, or kata in Greek, which means according to, by, as. And when you look at these books in the Greek, you'll see that it's not even going to say the gospel. It's not going to say euangelion kata markon. It's just going to say kata markon, kata lukon, kata yohanan. And so this is just the way they worded it. Early in the first century church, they would only have their names on it. And that's what would associate that letter to that person. So the gospel, according to Mark, in Greek means a defense. And actually, when you read it again in Greek, it's going to say kata markon. But that's his name, and this is what we're about to get into, the gospel, the good news, and what that means to us, and what it meant to them in their time. And so what I want to do is just to get us equipped, and almost an apologetics. I want us to be able to defend our truth of the gospel. I want us to be able to be equipped to know what the gospel means. This is the plan. And when someone questions you about the Word of God or the Bible, that we have just a little bit of knowledge so we can just quickly spit it out. So the gospel, again, the euangelion, the good news, is a part of a canon in the New Testament. The canon is a criterion by which something is judged, a collection of lists of sacred books or accepted as genuine. In short, it means a measure, a correct measure. The canon of the Bible are those books that measure up. And so we didn't just, and before all these books made it into what we know as the canon, there was other things being taught. There were other oral lessons being taught. There was other things in circulation that were going around about Christ, about the apostles. And so we have to look at these things and determine which one is actually the truth, which one is actually going to measure up to the truth and be taught in the churches. And so what we do now is we go to the qualifications of the canon. What are the three qualifications that we need for this letter or this epistle to be into the canon? Well, first one, it had to be linked to Jesus or a disciple or an apostle. So anytime we look at these books, they're always linked to one of these things. It's either Christ, an apostle, or a disciple. So the book of Mark, he's actually linked to Peter. James and Jude, they're linked to Christ and the other apostles because Christ was their brother. And we have 1 Peter, he was an apostle. And then we have the letters that Paul written, he was linked specifically to Christ because of his vision and also the other disciples. And so that's one way we get our gospel, our canon Bible, is again, we have to make sure it measures up. We have to sort through all the false doctrine, the lies that we're circulating. We have the gospel of Judas, the gospel of James, all these things that are false doctrines had to go in and be scrutinized and figure out which one it was. And then, so the second one is doctrinal soundness and historical accuracy, authentic work. Again, like I said, there was letters going around, so we have to find out which ones are authentic. The way they would do that is, again, linking these letters to apostles, disciples, or Christ. A lot of these didn't make the cut because a lot of these were false doctrine. They didn't have no soundness. The teaching wasn't accurate. And a lot of these had what I like to think in my mind is like are ghost writers. They're putting work under someone else's name. And those were, again, they were false. And so we had help with that. Watch, I'm going to go into number three. But before that, the third thing is the broad base acceptance by the early church. Now, this was the first century church, why these letters and oral traditions were going around. They heard the story of Christ, and now they're going from house to house, and they're like, hey, did you hear about this Messiah? And they'll break down word for word as best they can orally, or they'll have small letters, and they'll read them that way. But the broad-based acceptance of the early church had to make sure that they scrutinized these letters to make sure that this was accurate. And so we go now to the church fathers. I know I have only a couple names up there, but I want to bring one more name up before we even hit. Polycarp was a one who actually knew John. He was an early church father who came in communication and contact with John the Apostle. And through him, he had other students. And so this man was actually, again, knew the Apostle John, was able to meet with them, hear the stories of Christ. And Polycarp had, again, two students. One we see there is Papias, and one down below is Irenaeus. Now, Irenaeus was actually introduced first, and then Papias came later, according to the tradition. But they were both disciples of Polycarp. So Polycarp, knowing John, was able to feed these men the gospel truth. And so these are just some of the quotations from these early church fathers to authenticate the book of Mark. Papias in AD 140 said about the book of Mark, Mark, having become the interpreter of Peter, wrote down accurately whatsoever he remembered. Justin Martyr in AD 150 wrote down these were the memoirs of Peter. And then Irenaeus in AD 185 wrote the disciple and the interpreter of Peter. These were all accurate. These were all men who would claim and proclaim that the Gospel of Mark was very much accurate, very much authentic, and it couldn't be disputed, although there were some people who would dispute it, and even the years it was written. And so now we'll go into a little bit more historical context, and then we'll break into who Mark is. Many scholars have agreed that Mark's account was written first and used as a source by Matthew and Luke. Mark was likely written in the mid-50s to early 60s while in Rome. Again, there was other sources. We're not going to get too deep into this, but there was other sources that they would use. One of them was called a Q source. It's a German word, which I believe it's Quelle. They would use, and they would get this, and they would, and these were oral traditions or accurate writings that Mark would probably have used, the stories of Christ, to put his collection of stories together. And so again, Matthew and Luke used Mark, and if you look at the synoptics, you'll see Mark again is the shortest one, and then Matthew comes along second and builds up a little bit more, and then Luke the same way. They all have the same flow, the same story, and even when they break apart, geographically, they're all on the same place as long as you're putting Mark first, and you're doing that. If you put it out of order, it's going to get a little weird, but so we're going to have Mark first. We're going to have, again, his writing in the the mid-50s, early 60s, and we're going to break that down a little bit more. And now the background and setting of what was going on while he was writing this. Again, he was in Rome while he wrote this. And so while he was in Rome, he was writing to the Roman Gentile believers. Mark's account addresses the reality of the suffering and the persecution and serves to encourage them with his account of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So in that time, persecution was already happening. And so Mark, being in Rome, is writing to those believers to encourage them through the persecution. Hey, this is the story of Christ. This is our purpose. And he's trying to get the gospel out there. And he doesn't front load his book like we see in Matthew. Again, this is to the Gentiles. Matthew, you can see when you read it, he's getting the genealogy down. He's getting the background of all this Jewishness down to prove that Christ is the Messiah through the line of Abraham, through the Davidic line. Mark doesn't do that. Mark, again, is just straightway, hey, this is the beginning, and boom, just goes right off. Luke, same thing. He front-loads his book with a lot of historical context about Christ. Again, Mark is just right to the point. The themes that we're going to be looking at is Mark presents Jesus as the suffering servant of the Lord while discipling others how to serve and sacrifice. Mark highlights Christ's human side and reveals him as the Messiah, the Son of God. And so, just in a snapshot, the theme that we're going to be looking at as we're walking through this gospel is Christ as a suffering servant and discipleship. These are the themes. We're going to look at Christ in the early ministry when he starts off in Galilee, the middle part on his way to Jerusalem, and then we'll break those down as we get through it and as we get there. But those are the themes that we're going to be going through. And so now that we know a little bit of the date when it was written, kind of put your mind back there, the background setting. We're in Rome. His audience are Roman Gentile believers, and the theme is to show who Christ is, the suffering servant, and how to disciple others. So now that we know that, we're going to get to know the author a little bit. So we know Mark, but the first time we're introduced to him, and we've been talking about this through Colossians, actually, when we first heard Mark's name before this study, was in Colossians 4:10. But the first time we hear of Mark is going to be in Acts chapter 12, verse 12. And if you want to turn there, it's going to be a little silly, but to get to know Mark, we have to be in the book of Acts instead of the Gospel of Mark. The Gospel of Mark will actually never name Mark at all. So to get to know him a little bit more, we're going to look around. Mark is ubiquitous in this whole gospel. That's a big word I learned while I was doing this. Ubiquitous means he's kind of all over the place. He's here in this chapter, here in that chapter. So he's in there. So what I did is kind of put a storyline together for us so we can follow Mark through this and see what he was going through as he was trying to pin this gospel down. But before that, we have to know who he was. So if you want to turn to Acts chapter 12, we'll begin to fill in the story. And so I'll just read this part, and then we're going to put it into context. Acts 12:12 says, "So when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying." That's just a quick little snapshot of what we got. So just from this, we know that Mark had a mom named Mary, and that's pretty much it. We're introduced to him, but he's linked to Peter when we first see him. So we want to put a pin in that and remember that he's linked to Peter. So what's going on here, what introduces Peter to John is the persecution has already begun to happen. Stephen's persecution. So now the Jews have gone to Cyprus, to Antioch, to other places to flee the persecution, but Peter's hanging around. And the persecution gets so thick, so heavy, that in the beginning of this chapter, chapter 12, the brother of John, James, is actually beheaded. He dies by the hands of Agrippa. King Agrippa, it was a king at the time. Herod Agrippa was a king at the time. He was more of a politician. He would do things to please the people. And we're going to see that right now in chapter 12. Chapter 12. And it says in verse 1, "Now about the time Herod king stretched out his hand to harass from the church, then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread, so when he had arrested him, he put him into prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover." So again, we see that King Herod Agrippa has gotten the brother of John, James, and has beheaded him already. This was the first martyr, one of the first disciples, one of the first disciples that was martyred. And he's seen how it pleased the Jews, how it pleased the people. So he's like, you know what? We got another one. Let's hold on to Peter because now they're celebrating Passover. We don't want to do it or disturb anything while Passover. And I'll get those people's favor again. Once Passover is over, we're going to do the same thing to Peter. And so while Peter's being held in prison, he is guarded by four other security men there, and he's chained to them. And then at that night, an angel comes to him. Now, Peter already previously had a vision, so I want to get this in our head before we go any further. Peter had a vision of a sheep coming down and seeing clean and unclean animals. And this happened three times to him, and the Lord told him, hey, Peter, arise, kill, and eat. And he's like, that which is unclean, I'm not going to do. And the Lord tell him, hey, that what I call clean, don't call unclean, arise and eat. And after this, Peter's just dwelling on it, like, man, what does this mean? What does this mean? And then an angel tells him, hey, some men are coming to grab you. You need to go talk to Cornelius. So that was his first vision. So he knows what visions look like, what they are. But now he's in prison and he's there sleeping and he's chained up with men beside him on both ends. And an angel comes and hits him on his legs like, hey, Peter, arise, get up. Get your cloak on, get your shoes on. And Peter gets up thinking that this is a vision. He's had visions before. The angel leads him out of the prison, out onto a street, and now he's heading into Jerusalem again. The gates automatically open. And as Peter's going through and he comes to a house, the angel kind of moves along. It doesn't say that he disappears, but he's no longer with him anymore. And so now Peter's at a house, and this is where we're going to come up on the scene here. Acts 12:12. But before that, it says here that they were having a prayer meeting. At this house that they were at Mary's house, they were having a prayer meeting for who? For Peter. And so the word here that we're going to look at for girl, because there's a girl that comes down in verse 13, it says, and Peter knocked at the door at a gate. A girl named Rhoda came to answer. The word girl is pedeseke, and that means servant or maiden or bondwoman. So already just a snapshot of this, we hear Mary has a house. The dad is not mentioned, so we can gather that Mary's probably a widow, a very wealthy widow. She has a servant girl, and she has a son. And undoubtedly, they all probably came to faith when Peter had preached the first gospel sermon, because some 3,000 people were saved. Again, all the Jews were there in Jerusalem celebrating Pentecost. And so they were for sure one of the ones that were converted. And now they're having church at her house. And Mary, again, is a wealthy woman. They're upstairs having a prayer meeting. Rhoda, the servant girl, comes in. She's like, hey, you know, y'all were praying for Peter. Well, he's down at the door. Hey, get out of here. You know, we're praying here. We're really trying to pray through something here. And Peter's steadily knocking. And they're like, okay, it's probably just his angel. We're really trying to fast and pray here. But I thought that was funny. I mean, you're having a prayer meeting and you're not even believing in what you're praying in. And so as he's continuing knock, they finally go down there. They see it's Peter. They're all praising God. And he's like, no, let's keep it down. Peter comes in. And this is where we first see Peter. We see Mark with Peter. Later on, Mark begins to hang out with Peter, and he's in Jerusalem. So again, because of Peter, that family's converted. They believe in Christ. We read again where Mark comes in 12:25, and Mark actually meets Barnabas. And while we were studying Colossians, Didi had brought out that, and we'll get into this a little later, but Barnabas and Mark were actually cousins. And so Barnabas was hanging around all the time, but not only that, we meet Barnabas for the first time, I believe, in chapter 10. And he actually himself is like, hey, after he meets Paul or Saul, he's like, let me go look for Saul in Tarsus. And so this church is starting to come together. And let's take a pause real quick before we go any further, because when this letter was written and read, the church was under persecution in Rome. So if you can imagine that when you get a scroll and you're before the church, you're not comfortable in front of a home. You're probably in the catacombs under the cemeteries, and you're looking for places to hide to open up the scroll and be like, hey, we got a letter from Mark. And you sit down and you read it all in one take, and it may be an hour and a half, 2 hours, but that's what they did. And you had people kind of quiet listening just in case a Roman soldier would come in and begin to persecute the church. So this is what was the going on also in the background. And so again, Mark and Barnabas, Acts 12, 25, just 13 verses later, we're going to meet Barnabas again. If you've read Acts, this is probably the third or fourth time you've seen his name come up. And what is happening here is Herod is already dead, and certain prophets and believers had laid hands on Paul and Barnabas and sent them out because they see that a great famine is about to take place. So like, hey guys, we need you. You guys got to go to Jerusalem to send this this package, this food, this aid to Jerusalem to help them through the famine. So that's where they're at right now. So they're going to Jerusalem. Mark happens to be in Jerusalem. And so we're right here in verse 25. It says, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry, and they also took with them John, whose surname was Mark. So again, Paul and Barnabas giving relief to Jerusalem. There they meet a young man, John Mark. They take John Mark from Jerusalem. Now they're heading back to Antioch. That's like their base. You're going to read Antioch a lot in the book of Acts if you're going through it. And so now they're in Antioch, and they're about to go on another mission, but now they have Mark with them to help them out. So Mark is again being taught, being just at the feet of Peter at one time. Now he's with Paul. How amazing is that? Just to think to be a young believer and hanging around with the fathers of the church here. We didn't know that's how it was then, but these men were amazing. And so now we move a little bit further into Acts 13:5. And that says they also had John as their assistant. So that's the only other description that we have of Mark, is that he was an assistant. He was a minister or a servant. He would help Paul and Barnabas along with their mission. He wasn't a prophet. He wasn't an evangelist. He wasn't a leader in the church. This is what he did. They took him along so they could help. He would help them as they would go and evangelize the other places. Verse 5. And when they arrived in Salamis, they preached the word of God. Synagogue. Okay, so they're already on their first missionary journey. That's what happened between 12:25 and 13:5. Because again, the priests, the prophets have laid hands on Paul and Barnabas. And are like, we got to send you guys out to spread this gospel even further. And so they decide to do it, and they take John Mark as their assistant. So I put this so we can better see. This is where they're at in Antioch here. So again, they came from Jerusalem giving their gift. They brought Mark with them to Antioch. They've laid hands on him. And so now they're leaving Seleucia, this port, and they're going to Cyprus right here. And there they go to another port, Salamis. And so when they dock there, they begin to preach the gospel all the way till they get to the very end in Paphos. So Mark, being a young man, is with them, seeing people being converted, seeing people come to Christ. And then they run into the governor of Paphos or of Cyprus. And while they're there to try to teach this Gentile man, Paulus Sergius, I believe was his name, about the gospel, there was another man with them, and it was Elymas. And he was one who perverted the gospel. And he tried to stop them, or stop Sergius Paulus from hearing the gospel. Paul sees it, and Paul has, in my mind, he just has a stern look on his face. He's looking at this guy, and he's like, really? You're trying to, okay. And then he blinds him. He says, you know, you won't be able to see the light of day for a time, not seeing the sun for a time. And immediately a dark mist fell on him, and he went around seeking someone to lead him by the hand. Then the proconsul believed, and he saw what had been done, being astonished at the teaching of the Lord. So again, Mark is witness to all this. And I'm sure Mark, it doesn't say, well, we're about to get into it, but Mark's witnessing, man, this gospel has some power to it. These two men that he's with, his cousin and Paul, are really just teaching this thing, and people are coming to Christ. This is a new thing, by the way, back then. They're teaching the fulfillment of the prophecy that was said to them. 400 years of silence have passed, Book of Malachi, and now Christ is on the scene. And so now they're out there really pushing this gospel. Mark's with them. He's seeing all these amazing things. He sees this man fall. He's fallen to blindness. And so they travel. Is that it? Yeah, all the way to Pamphylia, to Perga from there. Once they do this mission, they go all the way up around here, and then Mark decides to do something in 13:13. So an actual chapter and one verse later, it says, "Now when Paul and his party set sail from Paphos, they came to Perga and Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem." Doesn't say why he abandoned them. It doesn't say why he left. We could just speculate. Maybe he got scared. Maybe he's seen Gentiles, Paul and Barnabas preaching to Gentiles, and it took. And he's like, oh, well, Peter wouldn't approve of that. But he didn't know. I mean, he didn't know the full story of what Peter already went through. And so, again, this is just speculation. Nobody knows exactly why he departed. He just departs. And that's kind of the last time we hear from him. For a while, actually, when he leaves there, and just to go back from here, so he's going from Pamphylia and he goes all the way back to Jerusalem. So that's a long trip to decide, you know what, I can't do this no more, or I'm not wanting to do this any longer, and he goes back. So again, says, now when Paul and his party set sail from Paphos, they came to Perga, Pamphylia, and John departed from them, returned to Jerusalem. And then we see, again, after some time had passed, and I want to go back to here because they continue on. Paul and Barnabas continue on that blue line there, going, just evangelizing. And once they get to Antioch, I believe, and then once they get there, Paul's like, hey, let's go back and revisit the places, encourage the brothers, see how they're doing. And it says here, now Barnabas was determined to take with him John called Mark. And a couple verses later, then the contention became so sharp that they parted from one another, and Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus. So what happened there was, Paul's like, man, I'm not having it. We were on a mission. Mark was with us, and he just up and leaves, and now we finish this mission. You want to go back, and you want to take the one who deserted us? It's like, no, man, he's not going to be able to go through this again. And Paul's set. Paul is on a mission. Paul's on fire. We read this through his books, and he has no time for all this other, you know, stuff that people are just going to be leaving, be deserting him. And so it actually says that they began to, Paul insisted that they don't take him, which means that Barnabas was insisting. So this thing got back and forth, like, no, we're taking Mark. He's my cousin. He's been with us. You know, I have to look after him. Paul's like, no, he abandoned us. When we needed him the most and we were going through these things, seeing this thing blossom, he left. And so we don't know the exact argument here, but Mark is rejected by Paul. They pick up Silas instead. Silas is like, hey, you know, a good convert. He's a faithful man in the gospel. So Paul ends up taking Silas, Barnabas takes his cousin, and they go back. They part ways, actually. So, again, they're in Antioch. Barnabas and Mark actually go back to Cyprus. This is where Barnabas is from. And so while they're there, they actually, Paul and Silas go the opposite way and make this huge track all the way around. We don't hear much from Barnabas for about 2 years. And we don't hear much from Mark for about 12 to 14 years. And finally, when we hear about Mark, it's in Philemon 1:24. And so something had happened there. Something happened to where now he's back in the picture. And Paul is writing about Mark. So I don't get lost. I just want to make sure. Okay. So we have to determine what happened within that 12 to 14 years of Mark being gone. Well, we can come to the conclusion that after he left and he went to Jerusalem, Peter was still hanging around. He was about 84 miles away in Caesarea. And so Mark ended up linking back up with Peter. He didn't stay with them the whole time, but they traveled. And they traveled to Rome. Peter was in Rome. He took Mark with him into Rome. And then Peter leaves, and you know, so there's some time there that Mark was with Peter. And that's where we see the link. Not only from when we first seen Mark in 12:12, but we're also going to see it again, as you see here in 1 Peter 5:13. But something amazing happens here in Philemon 1:24, because Paul's writing and he says, excuse me, and so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. So Mark is back in good stance with Paul. And again, these are the epistle prisons. This is Paul's first imprisonment. So he's writing these letters out, and he mentions Mark. And again, in Colossians 4:10, which we had just finished a couple weeks ago, Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you've received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. Again, Mark's back in the picture. The year 61 to 62 AD, so it's been about 12 to 14 years since they've seen each other. But again, in that time, they have came together, they've been reconciled, and now Mark is being used again for the gospel purpose. We know all this because, again, the letter Peter wrote. 1 Peter 5:13 says, she who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son. It's not his physical son, it's his spiritual son. So this means he was raising Mark as a young man in the gospel to spiritual maturity. And this is cryptic wording here. When he says she, he's referring to the church. And when he says Babylon, he's referring to Rome. So he's hiding it in a way, so because, again, the year 64-65 AD, Nero has already started that infamous fire of in July of 64, and he's beginning to blame it on the Jews. And so great persecution is happening. And so he's trying to hide this, like, this cryptic message to the people, to believers, so he doesn't stir up more persecution. So he writes again, she who is in Babylon, the church in Rome, is what he's saying, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does my son Mark. So Mark was at the feet of Peter, and while Peter was preaching the gospel day in and day out, and then just retelling stories like humans do, like, oh man, I remember one day I was hungry and we had nothing to eat and Jesus came, you know, just telling these stories, and Mark's just eating it up, writing all this down. And so this is how we're getting our gospel. It's not Mark's account because he's seen Christ. It's Peter's account through Mark. Mark was his spiritual son. We see it here. It's his son. So he's teaching him everything he knows about Christ, about the gospel. And this is how we're getting our gospel, our account of Christ. And then finally, we see more of a restoration because Paul's on his second imprisonment. He's about to die. He's about to go be beheaded. And in 2 Timothy 4:11, he says, Luke alone is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is very useful to me for ministry. Paul's at the last days. He's ready to be poured out like an offering. And who does he want with him? The deserter, the defector, the one that strayed away from him. So there was definitely a restoration that occurred there. And when you read that chapter, he says, Demas has also deserted me. So he has another deserter. And then now he's kind of all alone. And who does he want? He wants Mark. And so you think, how is that possible? How is a plain, young, simple person who deserted the faith or the mission to be used by that? How is God able to use that? But isn't that what we all are? We're defectors. We're backslidden people who've been restored, and we're returning back to the Father. That's the kind of people God uses. This is the kind of person God used. A young man, young in his faith, growing, not walking perfectly, and maybe he did make a mistake. But by God's good grace, he was able to come back in and be in restored fellowship with other disciples, with other believers. And maybe that's the case for us today. There's not going to be a whole lot of application through some of this, but what application I could try to give is just that. Maybe we're here today and we're like, man, I've messed up. I should have kept going on with the faith. Or I should have did this instead of that. God can use that mess. God can use you still and restore you back to where you need to be used by you. And I just want to use Peter, his words, for encouragement. I thought it would be fitting because this is almost his gospel. And so for the last encouragement words I'm going to leave us with from Peter, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood or your brothers and sisters in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. So there is still hope. Again, we shouldn't be so quick to count ourselves out. Maybe whatever Mark's situation was, he couldn't go through with it. But we do see him pop back up many times and seeing him being used and ultimately being used by God and by the Holy Spirit to pen the first gospel message so that we can all come to the knowledge of Christ. That is the lesson for today. If you have any questions, comments, now's the time to go ahead and do your thing.